Und da muss ich wieder okay sein.
Hey, good afternoon. Welcome to this webinar on forecasting. I see that people are still coming in progressively, but I think we will start with the people who are there. Before going into the topic itself, I would like to share three logistics aspects to the webinar for those who participate for the first time. To a movies webinar. It's always the same. The people who know our webinars probably know this. So at the end, I will keep some time for questions. You can raise your questions at any moment during the webinar. You will see in the webinar box, so in the GoToWebinar box, there is a part where you can ask your questions. If you have questions, just put them there and then I will pick them up and I will answer them. At the end of the webinar, I'll take some time at that moment to answer. Then, if you want a copy of my presentation of today, you can get it. Just send me an email or put it in the question box at the end, and then I will forward the presentation to you. And then the last thing is at the end when you close the webinar. Invites, you will get a survey. It's a very easy survey. It's about five short questions to understand what you thought of it. It's just a way for us to get better at webinars, understand what you like and what can be improved. Okay, so with that, I think we can get started. Before going into the three topics, I wanted to put make one slide just on the importance of forecasting, because sometimes some people are convinced about how important forecasting is. Sometimes others are stating that maybe you don't need forecast, or is it really as important? I just want to clarify my point of view before going into the topic itself. I think what is important to realize is that all supply chains. Somebody says that the presentation is not visible on the screen. So you saw me. Okay, this is probably better. Okay, I thought you wanted to see me, but if you want to see the topic, I can show you the slides. So all supply chains use some sort of forecast. And that is simply because companies and supply chains cannot react immediately. So we can figure out ways to speed up our reaction time so that we are less sensitive to forecast. But at some point, if we need to decide on investments or we need to take important decisions, at some point we need to make an estimate of what the future will bring. And that is basically what a forecast is. So of course, if we can better predict what is going to happen, we can take better decisions or decisions that will not become obsolete by future events. And if we are able to forecast on a longer horizon in a more or less reliable way, we will have time to implement our decisions without going into time pressure. So as such, having a way to better predict what the future will bring, right? Whether that is on very detailed product demand, or whether it would be more on long-term market evolutions, the better we are able to predict what can happen or what will happen, the easier it will be to be prepared when time comes. Yeah. Now, of course, and I want to put this into perspective right away, forecasting is not the only way to improve supply chain performance, right? You can make supply chains more responsive. There has been a lot of work the last years around demand-driven supply chains that make supply chains less sensitive to forecast errors, right? And all of these methods, of course, have their value in improving a supply chain, right? All of those methods use forecasts in some or other way, right? But they just make themselves more independent or more robust versus forecast mistakes. In this webinar, because it's a webinar that only takes 45 minutes, I will not consider those other ways of improving supply chain performance, but I'll just focus on the forecasting aspect itself, right? So I'm not saying that the other things are not important or that forecasting is the only solution. It is just one way to improve supply chain performance, as there can be many others. Okay, so in this session, the next 45 minutes, I will treat three topics. Topic number one will be about measuring forecast performance, and then especially using metrics to improve the forecasting process and improve forecast performance as such. The second topic will be about statistics, using statistical forecasts in the most efficient way. And then the last topic will be about how do we include commercial intelligence into a forecasting process in such a way that we can get more out of it than pure extrapolation of the past. Okay, so let's start with the measuring part, measure what you manage. To explain or to go to my message here, I need two concepts that I will introduce very briefly. The first concept is the one of forecasting metrics. I think you can consider that there are two important types of forecasting metrics, the one being forecast accuracy, so the measurement of are we able to forecast the right quantity at the right moment in time. And then the second metric will be forecast bias, so indicating are we able to forecast the right quantity on a longer period of time? So are we able to be good in the long run? Are we not over or under forecasting consistently, right? And probably most of you know these types of metrics. I will explain them very, very briefly with this simple example here, right? So I have a forecast of 100 per period. I have actuals that you can see here. If I start looking at forecast performance, I will always measure the difference between the forecast and the actual. And if I'm in accuracy, I will use absolute values. So the 30 will be a deviation of 30. The bias will consider this as a deviation of minus 30. And in this way, you can always add up the numbers, right? If you do an accuracy measure, the total error will be 130. If you do a bias measure, the bias will be only a 3% bias, right? Which means that if you look at a forecast accuracy number or a mean absolute deviation, which is the error number, the error number here will always be bigger than the bias number, of course, right? But they measure different things. Forecast accuracy says, am I able to forecast the right quantity in the right period? Bias will just say, in general, I am over or under forecasting. Yeah. Now, if you look at those two forecast measures, you can, in fact, understand by combining those two types of measures, you can understand what type of mistakes or how you can improve your forecast performance. And for that, I think you need a second aspect or a second understanding of a demand signal or a demand forecast. And it is that basically a demand forecast consists of four components. So four things that you will try to predict in some way. Right. The first thing you will try to predict is a level. It's a kind of an average sales level in the future, where then you would add up a notion of a trend, right? So is the demand in the future, is it going up progressively or going down progressively? You can add to that aspects of seasonality, which explain basically how evolutions or peaks and low sales periods in the past can be reproduced in the future, right? So assuming that holiday period is always high season for a certain product, or products are always sold in spring, these kind of aspects, whether it's in a year or in a month, it's kind of seasonality. And then the last component that you will add to that are events, right? Where we will forecast for a specific moment an increase or a decrease in the demand because we know that something will happen, right? So it's specific, it's a specific occasion with a start and end and an impact on the demand. And if we look at forecasting, all forecasting algorithms or processes will come back basically to these four elements: forecasting a level, a trend, adding a seasonality, and then working with events, right? Now, if we start with this and we combine that with accuracy and bias, we can learn quite some things about forecast performance and as such learn from the measurement. Yeah. Of course, the first thing that is important when we talk about metrics is forecasting metrics are a very good tool to learn or to teach an organization or a team about how they can improve their forecast, right? It's by measuring time and time again how good we are, what types of forecast errors we have made, that gradually we can improve our forecasting skills and avoid making the same mistakes again. Unfortunately, that learning effect goes away as soon as we start punishing based on forecast metrics. So forecast metrics should be something positive. Having a forecast accuracy that is low or where there are issues with forecast accuracy do not necessarily mean that we are bad. It just means that we have to dig in and figure out how we can improve the way we do forecasting. As soon as we go into punishing, we get into a kind of a defensive mode that will avoid the learning effect. So if we try to learn from it, we can look at those two things. So we have the accuracy on the one hand that we know now, right? So an accuracy of 100% means that I'm perfectly right, the right quantity in the right period. And then I have the bias that I can measure. Bias should be close to zero, right? Zero means that the total forecasted volume and the total actual volume are equal to each other. So you're looking at the ideal forecast is a forecast with an accuracy. And I put here a number to give an idea, of course, in function of sectors and environments. When I say accuracy above 80 is good in some environments, that can be different, of course. But if you want one number, you can consider an accuracy above 80% as a pretty okay forecast accuracy. Biases should be below 5. To be okay, right? So if you see that you have an accuracy above 80%, bias lower than 5, probably that's a pretty good forecast that you have made, right? And now you can start looking. If you see that you don't reach these accuracies, you can have situations where in fact your accuracy is pretty okay, so around 80 or not too far away from 80, but you still have forecast bias that is higher than that 5%. Right, so you have bigger biases, whether they are positive or negative, which means that you're structurally over or under forecasting the demand. In that case, that means, in fact, that in your forecast, you have an issue in forecasting levels and trends. Right? So if you just have issues to forecast ups and downs, right? In general, the forecast bias would end up more or less correctly. It's only when you see that you have very strong positive or negative biases, that means that even your average forecast or your total forecast over a longer period of time is not aligned with the actual. And that is a big issue. Yeah, this is specifically a big issue because if you try to absorb forecast errors by using buffers, buffers will not help you a lot in these cases. Because if your forecast bias is constantly negative, so you are forecasting less than you are actually selling or consuming, your buffer will run out constantly, right? And you will never be able to complete it because every time again, you underestimate the demand and you get into a system where your buffer gets used up and you never get back on a reasonable level, right? In other cases, you can come in situations where, in fact, your bias is okay and your forecast accuracy is low, right? In those cases, it's specifically seasonality and events that need to be covered for, right? So it's looking into forecasting processes or tools that are better at figuring out what the seasonality is, right? Or having better processes to identify events in the future and forecast them correctly. Yeah? To the forecasting of seasonality and events, there is a limit, because that is typically something that can take more and more effort, more and more time, right? At some point, you could decide also to work on buffers, right? And build in sufficient buffers in your system to avoid getting into trouble every time there is an issue with seasonality and events that you have not foreseen, right? This is also the type of forecast error that demand-driven supply chains would be less sensitive to, because they use forecast in a different way, right? If levels and trends are wrong, no supply chain can survive correctly. If seasonality and events are forecasted not completely correctly, you can probably get it buffered somehow. At the end, of course, you can be at the lower right quadrant, so where both are wrong. In that case, try to improve level and trend first, because there's no way that you can buffer them away. And only if level and trend are under control, then look at seasonality and events. Yeah, there's two reasons for that. First of all, this is more important. Secondly, most of the time, forecasting levels and trends is much easier than improving the forecast of seasonality and events. This is typically far more time consuming. Yeah. The second message on measuring forecast and learning from forecast measures is measure the forecast that you use, right? We all know that the forecast is defined by the level of detail. So you can make an aggregate forecast, you can make a very detailed forecast, short-term or long-term. And normally, forecast complexity increases if you try to make more detailed forecast on a longer period of time. Yeah? That is kind of basic, right? What can happen now? So in some cases, you can use aggregated long-term forecasts. Like if you would use your forecasts to make decisions about capacity investments, so S&OP type of decisions, right? In that case, you will use a long-term forecast. So you look at 6 months, 12, 18 months forecasts on an aggregated level. If you use this forecast, you should, of course, try to measure the accuracy or the performance of that forecast on this level, right? And what we sometimes see is that companies measure a forecast that is somewhere here. So they measure a very detailed short-term forecast, so a forecast on a customer level or on an SKU level on a short-term horizon. If you do this while you use this, you come to a situation where your forecast metric will put too much focus on the detail. So you will see forecast errors that are extremely important, right? That put a lot of focus on having the right quantity forecasted in the right month, right? But while you're spending time on trying to get a forecast that is right in detail on the product level and on the right quantity in the right month, you might lose time, and you might spend too much time, so that you don't have time left to look at long-term trends and evolutions. If you make a forecast for this kind of utilization, so S&OP type or long-term plan type of decisions, you should be measuring also the accuracy and especially the bias of your forecast on that horizon. Yeah? You could, of course, come to the other situation, right? If you use forecasts for more operational distribution planning type of decisions or production planning type of decisions, where typically you have a higher level of detail, right? So this forecast is more complex to make, right? Then again, you should, of course, measure this kind of forecast. And what happens sometimes is that then, for simplicity reasons, forecasts are measured in an aggregated way on a very short term. So sometimes looking at the total volume forecast for next month, right? And then sometimes you can come to situations where, in fact, total volume forecast for next month is close to 100%, right? You get accuracies that are 95, 96, 97, whatever. Very good forecast accuracies, right? Where you could think, in fact, you're very good at forecasting, but you're measuring something that you're not using, right? And in that case, you can create for yourself or for your organization a false feeling of accuracy, right? In general, the total number is fine, but if you look at the details, right, the details are wrong, right? So you don't focus enough on the right quantity at the right moment, right? Or you just, because you think everything is well forecasted, there is no focus on improving that forecast or building the right buffers, right? So the rule for me is look at what you do with that forecast. What's the horizon you are using? What's the level of detail you are using in your decision process, in your planning process, and then set up a forecast measure that measures the forecast accuracy and bias at the same level of detail. Yeah, that brings me to the end of my topic on measuring, right? There's for me two learning points, that is use that forecast accuracy and bias to figure out what the main reasons are for deviating or having forecast issues. And then secondly, make sure that you measure the forecast you're using and not something that is looking at a different horizon or a different level of detail. Second topic is getting the statistics right. I think statistics and statistical forecasting is very important in having an efficient forecasting process. I will see gradually why I think that. First of all, I think we can, I would like to give a quick overview of methods and their utilization. Also, there, I think it's important to realize that specific forecasting methods and specific statistics are good or less good at doing specific types of forecasts, right? Of course, the entry-level statistical forecast is simple methods like a moving average or a simple exponential smoothing type of forecasting algorithm, right? These algorithms are very simple, are very easy to understand, because basically they forecast that the future demand will be a kind of a weighted average of the past demand, right? So they are pretty simple to understand. Everybody can quickly learn to know how are they working and what are they doing and how do they react to specific events. They're pretty good at forecasting a level, right? So if they make a forecast, it will be the same number for all periods in the future, right? And then if you go to the last one, you can probably even include trends, right? The most important things about using these methods is, well, that you is selecting the right period of history, because you can use more or less history to make your forecast a little bit more or less sensitive to the last periods of time. Yeah, but of course you will need to do manual efforts around that forecast. If there are trends in the demand, those trends will need to be coped with manually or with another technique. If you want to use seasonality or add seasonality, you'll need another technique again to add seasonality to the demand signal, right? And everything related to events should then be treated manually. Manually being both in getting events out of the past signal and getting events included in the future signal. Yeah? So these forecasting methods are easy to use, are easy to understand, give a good base forecast. If you're just interested in forecast bias, so just a long-term stable forecast of the future, probably these kind of methods can do the trick. But of course, if you're looking for seasonality or trends, these models will be at their limit extremely quickly. Yeah. There is a logical extension or a quick extension to these models. It's a Holt-Winters model. The Holt-Winters model is a model that allows to take into account seasonality, right? So typically, this is the first model where you will see that the forecast for the next few or for the next months is different month after month, because Holt-Winters assumes that there is a seasonality, right? You can basically do a lot of things with these type of forecast models. right? What is important to realize, I think sometimes it is not realized well enough, is that a Holt-Winters model treats everything as seasonality, even if it is not. Yeah? A Holt-Winters model does not have an understanding or an intelligence saying, is that a seasonality or is it just a variation? Yeah? These kind of models assume that if you have sufficient history, that on average, every period, if there is not a real seasonality, that every period will balance back to an average sales. But of course, if you use these kind of seasonality models with a history of only 1, 2, or 3 years, the number of data points you have available to average out fake seasonalities is extremely low. So you can get a risk of increasing and decreasing demand from 1 month to the other or from 1 week to the other, just because by coincidence, you sold more of a product over the last two years in that same period. So if you have very long histories, or if you have histories with 5 or 10 years history, these kind of models can come to a seasonality that is probably a real seasonality. If you use the same logic with only a history of 2 years, you can get variation in your demand signal that is not real seasonality. And then the question is it better to forecast a fake seasonality or to forecast no seasonality at all? No? These are the four most basic forecasting models. All of these models, as you see here, as I wrote here, are based on the sales history of the product itself. So all of these forecast models look at the historical demand of a product and then add or try to extrapolate that demand to the future, right? The next two models that I added here are more advanced. They look a little bit the same. Box-Jenkins models and the multilinear regression models are models that look for correlations between parameters, right? Where a Box-Jenkins model will look for kind of seasonality patterns that can have different periods or different frequencies, right? So it will look at the regression or like a kind of an optimized weighted average from the previous demand, which can come to better seasonalities and better predictions of peaks and lower periods of sales. Multilinear regression models are models that will do the same thing. So look at correlations and regression factors, but with outside numbers, right? And these forecast models are typically the domain where we see artificial intelligence come in now, right? Where artificial intelligence is doing exactly that, trying to figure out what correlations are, what the patterns are that can be seen between outside parameters or historical sales, and as such predict what the future will look like, right? By looking at these regression factors. So this is typically the domain of artificial intelligence. What we should realize, I think, if we are looking into using this in real life situation, is the presence of sufficient historical data, right? Whether it is to set static parameters for multilinear models or Box-Jenkins models, and certainly if we go into the logic of artificial intelligence, these methods need sufficient historical data to learn actually what the patterns are that are relevant and what are the irrelevant patterns, right? So what we will see is that if we want to really profit or use these models in an efficient way, the storage and the availability of historical data will become more and more important, right? Which will have a bit of a side effect in environments where there is a lot of product or a lot of new products, right? Where for a specific product, the sales history will always be extremely short. In those cases, using substitution tables saying this product is like that product will become important because you will have to build your own long-term history data based on previous products, predecessors and successor types of products, right? So for me, the main message here is the more advanced the tool or the method becomes, the more you will be depending on long histories and good availability of historical data to initialize and set up the parameter, right? I wanted to make a little pass around probabilistic forecasting. If you look at more advanced systems and systems that are present in the domain of artificial intelligence, I think this is a very interesting concept that is very present in artificial intelligence, but it's different than what we are used to in terms of forecasting. So what makes probabilistic forecasts different than single value forecasts are basically where a single value forecast answers the question, how much will we sell next period? The probabilistic forecast answers the question, how big is the chance that we will sell more or less than X pieces? Yeah. So instead of just trying to figure out what the right number is, a probabilistic forecast will indicate what the probability is that a certain number will come true, right? Which is a very different way of looking at forecasting. But it has a couple of advantages, right? The first advantage, of course, is that probabilistic forecasting makes the uncertainty explicit. Yeah? Probabilistic forecasting will not say the number will be 100, but it will say there is a probability of 50% that the number is between 90 and 110, right? So the uncertainty becomes explicit, which allows for better decision making. You know that it's not just a number, but there is an uncertainty around it. And as such, the link with buffers is also easier to make. Yeah. So this is something that comes up. It's very present in the domain of artificial intelligence because it's very close to what artificial intelligence does from the start, right? So we will probably see more and more applications of these probabilistic forecasting methods, and I think from a pure sales forecasting perspective or demand forecasting perspective, they are extremely promising. Yeah. The last message around tools and forecasting methods is to build the skill that goes with the tools. I sometimes compare it to driving a Formula One car. Formula One cars are extremely performing cars. They can go very fast, but if you don't know how to drive it, they don't bring you anywhere. And I think with forecasting techniques, the logic is the same. If you want to have a good utilization of forecasting models and forecasting techniques and avoid going to results that you don't control and that are completely ridiculous, it is important that the people who use the models know the models, right? None of these models is completely inaccessible to human beings, so most of us can learn how they work, what their strengths and weaknesses are, but it's almost unacceptable to have people using these models who have not at least a basic understanding of how they work, right? Another interesting approach that you can think of is to let people test models and learn how to use them based on historic data, right? So the advantage of using historic data and testing models on historic data is that people can get immediate feedback on whether the forecast they made was good or bad. And what a lot of studies have shown is that people learn best if they get immediate feedback on their actions. And in most forecasting processes, that is not possible because you make a forecast and then you wait for a month, 2 months, 3 months, 6 months before you see the actual. Right? And as such, even if you try to measure and you take the right measures, etc., the learning effect is always slow because it takes time to see the actual coming in and then trying to figure out what happened, etc. Right? If you can test, if you can learn with historic data, just making forecasts and then checking if your historical forecast was in line with the real actual, you can learn much quicker, right? And there is even, if you're interested in the topic, there's an interesting article. This has been published last year in the Harvard Business Review about a company called Twitch. It's an Amazon company, if I'm not mistaken, where they explain how they learn, how they build a training program around forecasting based on historic data. So they let people forecast events and then they show them the results, right? And they do that multiple times so that people actually learn what to look at and what is working and what is not working in terms of forecasting. So it's an extremely efficient way to speed up the learning process and get people really mastering their way of forecasting and understand what should I do and what should I not do. Yeah. Okay, and then I have before I go to the sales part, as a way to go from the statistical forecast to the sales forecast, I have a game for you to also be a little test for me. I will show you a little problem and I would like to ask you to respond to it. So let me show you the case, right? Okay, so this is the story. You have a cab that was involved in a hit and run accident. So the cab ran over somebody, the person died, and the cab continued, right? And now, but the good news is we have a witness, right? We have two cab companies, by the way, in the company, in the city, there is a green cab company and a blue cab company, right? The greens have green cabs, the blues blue, of course. Yeah. We have a witness, there's two things we know. 85% of the cabs in the city are green, 15% of the cabs in the city are blue. So there are more greens than blues. But we have a witness, and the witness said, I have seen the cab that ran over the poor guy, and it was blue. Right? And the court has tested the reliability of the witness. So they have shown blue and green taxis in similar circumstances, and the witness was able to identify the two colors, so green and blue, correctly in 80% of the cases. Yes. And now, of course, you have to decide what is the probability that the cab involved in the accident was actually blue. Yeah. So open a poll. So now you can answer. Let's see, a few more answers. This is especially fun for me because I know the answer, right? I will not leave too much time. Good. Let me close it. Yeah. Somehow I should be able to show this poll. I don't know how, so I will continue. Do you guys see it? I don't know if you see it. Anyway, I will tell you what the result is. 44% of you said 80%, 33% said 60%, 11% said 50, and 11 said 20%, right? So most say 80% and 60%. Yes, the right answer to this question is 41%. So the probability that the cab involved in the accident was blue is 40%. Yeah? The main reason, or the reason for that, is that 85% of the cabs are green, right? So the chance, the base rate chance that the cab was blue was only 15%. right? Making that the chance in the end, if you combine the two probabilities that the cab was actually blue, is only 40 and not 80, right? I took this, so the answer is certainly correct. I did not calculate this for myself. I just copied this from this book here by Nobel Prize winner Daniel Kahneman. So he did the calculation. I imagine that in such a bestseller, there cannot be a wrong result. What I want to tell you about this is, do not underestimate base rates, right? Sometimes we are intuitively, if we make a statistical kind of forecast, we look at the base rate, we look at the average of the demand over time. We have a natural tendency as humans to underweight, to underevaluate the value of that historical number, right? Because we think that we have specific information of a future case available, right? But we overestimate the value of that individual information, and we underestimate the importance of the base rates, right? If you really want to be convinced, you can definitely read this book. It's a great read. But it is something that is very important to realize when we talk about forecasting and about statistics, how important or how good base rates are as predictions of the future, and how bad we are as human beings to work with them, right? And you see that in something that again, Kahneman calls the planning fallacy, which is the phenomenon where plans and forecasts are unrealistically close to best case scenarios, right? And where in fact, if you look at a distance to a probable sales number, right, that in fact you get much closer to what it will be than the best case estimates we are using. And again, as human beings, if we make plans, if we make objectives, we hope to realize them, and we underestimate the fact that there are plenty of reasons for not reaching our best case scenario, right? And that is where statistics has a big added value. If statistic pulls us back to what base rate numbers are, right? It can make sure, or it could help to avoid getting into these extreme planning fallacies. But you'll have to kind of control our natural intuition to go immediately into the specific case and respect that statistics or base rates have a predictive value, right? I hope my little example of the 80% helps you to remember that. Yeah. So in brief, second part, get the statistics right, pick the right technique for the right demand component, and make sure that you have, that your people have the skills that go with the tools, right? If you have a great tool, you have great methods, but nobody knows how to use them, how to use the parameters, where to use them, what is good, what is bad, there is no guarantee that the result is good. Yeah. Last part, tap into commercial intelligence. I will start this part on commercial intelligence with a bit of a provocative statement. Yeah. This is a provocative statement. I'm saying, in many cases, salespeople get tricked into forecasting against their will and against their skill. And after that, they get beaten because their forecasts are unreliable. Yeah. And I will now explain this and try to give some ideas of what you can do about it. It's what I see in many cases. Sales gets pushed into getting involved in the forecast, and a lot of salespeople are not convinced about the use of it, or are not really willing to do it, but are kind of forced to go into a forecasting process, right? And they're not necessarily very good at it, right? And then, of course, yeah, forecasts are unreliable, and we continue to discuss about the unreliability of the forecast, right? I think the first thing we should realize is that forecasting is not a natural skill. You can just answer these questions for me. How many salespeople are selected for their forecasting skills? Salespeople are not chosen for forecasting skills. They are chosen for many other skills, but not the fact that they are good at forecasting, right? How many salespeople have a degree in business modeling or statistics? Very few. And again, we expect them to use data in an efficient way to make a prediction of the future. Right? How many salespeople like to work with large Excel sheets? It can continue like that, right? But also from a company perspective, how many companies send their new sales staff to a forecasting course? Yeah. If you take all of these things together, it is logical, it's understandable that we're asking a sales staff or a sales team to make forecasts, but it's not in their nature. They are not really trained for it. And then we expect them to do a good job, right? Which is extremely difficult, right? So the first thing we can do to get sales people or to get sales departments involved in a forecasting process and get to better forecast performance is to put professional forecasters in the commercial teams. So this make a distinction between a forecaster who has all of these skills, right? Who is trained in forecasting, who knows statistics, who likes maybe the large Excel sheet or the big tool with the, all the numbers, right? But have that person close to the sales so that sales information gets naturally pushed to the forecaster, right? And I will explain the independent part in two slides, right? Because it's important, of course, that that forecaster is not just plugging in numbers, but can have his own logic and his own understanding of reality. And I've seen this work in practice with pretty good results, right? The second idea I wanted to place is the ask for facts instead of figures, right? It is true, of course, that salespeople are often the only people in an organization who have information about likely events in the market or at customers, right? Salespeople are the first people to know that a customer will, or that there will be a new contract with a new customer, or that a customer will go away, or that something is happening in the market. They have this information about events, and we would like, of course, to have this information into our forecast, right? However, what can be difficult for a salesperson is to estimate the impact of the event. Yeah. So the salesperson knows that there will be this or this client that will come. And in some cases, the salesperson can have an idea of what the additional sales can be, right? But the difficult part is not to know that the event is there. The difficult part for the salesperson is to estimate its impact on the demand, right? And by asking for those figures, we add complexity and we slow down the sharing of the information. So by pushing people to give a number, right, we slow down the fact that the information is passed on. Right? Where an alternative can be to find a way, an easy way for the salesperson to share knowledge about the event, right? There will be a new contract, there will be a promotion at this client, or this customer will go away, these kind of events, right? Have those shared in an easy way, and then use knowledge of past events to estimate the volume impact. Yeah. Again, this comes back to the start of having sufficient historical data, right? Because of course, to estimate volume impacts from past events, you need to be able to identify the past events in the past and then have a library of historical events that you can use for reference. Yeah. But again, this is not something new. The companies do this, right? But it's, I think, a very interesting way of involving salespeople on something they are strong at, right? Sharing information on what might happen, right? And take out of your expectation the fact that they do the translation into volumes, right? But put that then back into the role of a forecaster who can actually use past events to make that that forecast or that estimate, right? And then the last point in this section is the distinction between forecasts and objectives. I think again, this is a traditional discussion point, right? Where companies or organizations have sales targets or budgets on the one hand, and then make forecasts on the other hand, and so at some point feel the pressure to have a forecast that is in line with an objective or a forecast that is in line with a budget, right? And then I have a couple of questions, right? Of course, forecasts are an estimate of what is expected to happen, right? Where objectives are a target to aim for, right? And as such, already the two types of information are completely different. On the one hand, I estimate, I say, I think this is what is going to happen. On the other hand, I'm saying, this is what I like to achieve, right? And then again, if you're, whether you think from statistics or you think from real life, right? You can answer these questions. How big is the chance that all sales entities or all salespeople reach their target? If I put an objective, how big is the chance that everybody will reach his or her objective, right? And how big is then the chance that they will all hit their target exactly, right? The chances are very high that some will reach it, some will exceed it, some will be below it, right? But the chance that everybody reaches the target exactly is extremely low, right? So what is then the use of trying to make sure that forecasts are exactly aligned with budgets or objectives if you know that it's very unlikely that this is going to happen, right? And there my very simple opinion or recommendation is treat sales targets or objectives as scenarios, right? You can perfectly, we can perfectly live and we should in planning processes live with different demand scenarios where we can have a most likely forecast that is independent of the objective and that shows if the demand expresses itself or if the demand is as we think it will be, this is the number, right? And then we should prepare for XYZ and at the same time look at and what would be the scenario if everybody reaches his objective? And then compare the scenarios and see what we need to do and then take decisions based on explicit risks. But trying to make forecasts and objectives align is, to my opinion, a way to hide an uncertainty that is a real uncertainty and as such come to decisions that are losing part of the valuable information. Right. So it brings me to my conclusion, right? So number one was measure what you manage, right? Use forecast accuracy and bias metrics to learn and to understand what type of mistakes you are making and thus what should be improved, right? The second topic, second message is work on those statistics, make sure that statistics does most of the work, use the right techniques, make sure that your people understand those techniques so that they can use them correctly. Do not underestimate their value, right? And then use commercial intelligence smartly by having a good relationship between the forecasters and the salespeople, right? And ask for facts instead of figures so that you can have the information but then transform it based again on past events. And of course, avoid treating objectives as forecasts but use them as just another demand scenario. I will leave this slide on and look at the questions that we have received. If you still have questions, you can still raise them. We'll see them over time. So the first question is, what can you do if salespeople are just not motivated to spend time on forecasting. Of course, it happens often. It's people are pushed into doing a job where they're not specifically motivated for. Personally, apart from the training perspective, I think one of the most important elements or ways to get people involved or salespeople involved in the forecasting process is to also involve them into the decision process that uses the forecasts. Right? I think it's kind of logical that if people ask you to do to fill in a lot of numbers, and then you send out those numbers to somebody and you don't know what happens with the number, how it is used, and then if you don't see how important those numbers are, your motivation goes down very quickly, right? So by making the decision process transparent, or even involve salespeople into the decision process, they become much more involved also in the forecasting aspect. So I think that's involving people in a decision process will definitely help to get them motivated into the forecasting. Let me have a look at what is still coming. Yeah, there's a question about the relationship between statistics and sales. I have probably provoked a little bit. Where do you use statistics, and how do you involve sales? Should sales validate a forecast? I still think that a final forecast on an aggregated level can be validated or can be discussed with sales. First of all, because it is part of a commitment, of course. Also because there is a kind of a intuitive understanding that can be brought in by having that validation. Where I would be specifically careful is if forecasts are significantly are very different than base rates. If commercial forecasts are very different than statistical forecasts, those are cases where I would be careful to go blindly for a commercial forecast. Right. I think that's about the end of the presentation. So I would like to thank you to have taken the time to listen to me. Again, if you have other questions, you can always drop me an email on the email address that you see here. If you drop off, if you log off, I would be very grateful to you if you would take just two more minutes to fill in the questionnaire. That definitely helps me to understand what you thought of it and how we can do better next time. So thank you very much. And have a good afternoon.